Oh, it's gone quiet.
Alright everyone, hi, thanks for coming, those of you that don't know me, it's professional practice. Really quickly, I'm introduced to Stephen, who's our guest speaker. We don't get many of these at FGCU, so we really need to take advantage of people that are from industry. Given that some of you in about a year or less are going to be going into some sort of industry, so these are people you need to pump for information and get as much out of them as you possibly can. So without further ado, Stephen, good luck. Thank you.
So again, my name is Stephen Craig, and I come from a background of production management, and I've worked in live-action film, TV. I've also worked in feature film, animation, commercial, as well as video game production. So my overall talk is not to bore you with Gantt charts and spreadsheets and things like that, although that is part of the production process. But what I hope to impart to you all is, in my experience managing artistic and technical staff, how all of that works inside of making a video game or making a film project, whether it be, you know, independent, small budget, feature film, that type of thing. So that's my goal. I'm going to go through some slides. I also have some production examples. And just to kind of get a sense of the audience, what is the makeup? Is everybody in digital design? Are people in other curriculum? Are people traditional artists? Show of hands. Okay. So we have some people that are in, so some people paint, some people do Photoshop, digital. Okay. So in my experience, I've worked with all types of art staff, and as I mentioned, I'll go through that. So again, I've already talked briefly about my experience. I'm a graduate of Ohio University, communications, minored in TV and film production. I moved up to New York City, worked on the Equalizer hand, if anybody knows who the Equalizer is. Law and Order, because it's still going on. I worked on the pilot. I'll explain a little bit of that. It's a long time ago. Stanley and Iris is a feature film that had Robert De Niro and I'm going to forget her name, Jane Fonda. And then I moved down to Orlando, which is where I did a bulk of my career there. The Disney MGM Studios was in a full-service post-production facility, and there I did the operations and scheduling, so I handled all of the clients that were coming in, whether they were booking an edit session, they were doing a graphic session, they needed audio sweetening, Foley, they also were going to do TV, the Mickey Mouse Club there with Britney Spears, and all of our popular stars now were basically cast members back in the day. Thank you. And so at that point, when the studios were opening up, Universal and MGM were fighting to get production down in Orlando. And so I worked at their facility. I wanted to get back into sort of film, and I didn't really like the live action side of things. I like working more in a team environment and in a more collaborative effort there. So my first production was going over to work on Mulan, which was at that point called the Florida feature. So anyway, worked several films there, went on to Project Firefly Animation Studios. That was after the Walt Disney feature studio was closed in 2004. A lot of the production was moved over to California. And then this was an independent production company. And then I moved over to manage the art staff with Nspace. And currently, in moving down to Fort Myers, I am in freelance. I've moved down here for personal reasons, and I'm transitioning a lot of my skills into freelance project and event management. So some of my projects will have some of this aspect to it. Some of them will just strictly be events. So, as you are all looking at how you graduate and transition your skills, we constantly are doing that in the industry because it's always changing. So first of all, working with the artistic staff, be careful of what you say to an artist because it can be quickly put into a drawing. So anyway, I happened to be going through a shoulder injury and I explained, oh, they had to wrap my shoulders and so now I'm looking like a mummy, and then there's my physical therapist. And oh, when I was a kid, I had eye teeth and they extended down and I had them shaved off and so now I have tusks. So you have to. Feature animation was brutal because if you saw, because everybody was armed with pencil and paper, and if they were making eye contact, you knew there was a drawing at the end of the meeting, and then everybody would just be like, "Oh, did you see Rick's? Did you see whatever?" So that's what makes it fun. And so overall, the art production process, you know, we can divide it into some specifics here, but overall, there's pre-production work. There's production work, post-production, and sort of the aftermath of all of that, which is marketing. A lot of this can also cross over. In the event of working with Disney or with Universal, obviously merchandise tie-ins, publicity, theme park, interactive, E3 is pretty much specific to the video game process. But anyway, what tends to happen is representatives of those groups will need, they have their own timeline and their own agenda, and sometimes it's running counter to what the production process is. So most of my time with Disney Feature Animation was managing what was called the CGI department or the digital production department, which at that point was known as the black box because nobody really understood it. Our goal was to integrate 3D elements into a traditionally hand-drawn movie. And that was our goal, was 2D, 3D integration. Because at that point, all of the movies that we worked on were hand-drawn movies with elements that were determined CG as we went through what the story was. So again, I'll touch on those. And again, if you've got questions, write them down. We'll go over that in our question and answer period. So pre-production, we've got a lot of stuff that goes on, and again, this is broken down into various different departments. So we've got storyboards that are going on, there's workbooks. I actually have an example. This is a Curious George workbook. So that every sequence that went into production, it actually was storyboarded, and then was turned, those storyboards get scanned in and editorial compile or basically edits them together, they get their timings down. And once the directors and everybody buy off on that, then it becomes approved into production. And then this massive workbook basically becomes your production Bible. It's got the breakdown of what the effects are, it's got with the layout, the camera move, and the person in the layout department had to photocopy many, 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 many copies of this. So this will be available, but again, in our production, this is what would happen. And then anytime you had a revised page, they made any changes, you had to make sure that you were looking, you know, for the latest and greatest, because that's basically how our production process was before a lot of stuff was done digitally. So concept art. So for people that love to create you know, universes, or like to take reference from a specific artist and then translate that into a feeling of a sequence or an area of a film, that's what our concept art would do. And they would usually work with an art director, and they would come up with, here's our style, here's what we're looking for, and here's what we're trying to achieve. And then we would say, okay, take this sequence, and we need, you know, let's say, for instance, Mulan, the Hun charge. It's going to be, you know, mountainside. We're going to need to focus on an avalanche at some point. What's our effects style? They looked at the Chinese art styles, and they tried to get a lot of the, if people have seen Mulan, they've tried to get some of that, you know, sort of scripty and scrolly type of effect in there. So all of that sets the tone throughout the production, and then that artwork is available. It'll eventually become hand-drawn, and then the background artist will paint it, and then that will live as reference. So anybody that wants to see that, that wants to get the color, wants to study that, then they just work with those departments. You know, that's how a lot of the look and the feel was set. The development of the CG elements. There's the modeling, the rigging, there's the look development. In regards to Disney feature animation, in order for 2D, 3D integration to work, our 3D elements, they couldn't stand out like a Pixar render and really be shiny and really dimensional. We had to do a pass of the element. We had to take the tones, make it look like a tune shaded render, and then also to make it blend even better, we had to create colored ink lines, and then that would help integrate the element into the environment. And I've got some examples of that I'll show you. Model sheets for characters, for effects, color studies. Then you get into my side, which is production process, quota schedules, design docs. But again, like I said, in a feature film arena, all of this is a collaborative effort because it's not just one person, it's a whole team effort that's needed in order to get the work done. And then for people that are in the animation department, they're going to work with an assistant production manager. That person is going to tell them, hey, we've got X amount of footage in your department, here's what you can try to project for the week. Feature film was done in a footage count per week that we had to get. And so my job, if you were all my crew, I couldn't just expect you to say, oh, you're gonna go out and get your scene, you're gonna get your scene. I had to look at what was coming in the production pipeline to see what was gonna feed the different characters. Because again, you could have scenes come through and it could be one character. Well, if that doesn't get done, we're gonna fall short. So a lot of that is the integration of the work between the artist and the management staff back and forth to see. And then we worked with a calendar for the directors. And then I worked to get time. And so if it was Monday, I wanted to show the scene early so you guys could get notes. And then you had the notes right from the directors. You took those notes, you went back, you had the workbook, you've got all the information, you can look at the reels, and you go to town and you create your scene. And then you show it again, hopefully it gets approved, you work on your tie downs, you get everything completed, and then that's gonna be counted for the week. And then we had to watch that as the production went, because if we kept missing quota, then our curve would go up at the end, and then that's where crunch comes in, and overtime and all that good fun stuff. So here's some character design. Some of my examples are from various different projects. This is from a video game. But again, the concept artist on the far right-hand side was able to capture his look and feel in that sort of ISO character that was in the game. And so we'll create these. We'll also create a lineup so that in any, whether it's 2D or 3D, you have to have scale. So everybody has to know how to draw a character within the scale of the other ones. If you have a shorter character, or taller character, or wider character, if it was a monster, or if it was a boss character, or something like that. Again, fully rendered images of what the look and feel. Again, this is from the next gen version. And another aspect of production is sometimes it's all done in-house. And other times we're getting elements from the next gen, in regards to a video game production, we're getting assets from the next gen studio. And then we have to work in resing them down for our game, if it's Wii or DS, or we have to basically take this character design and then I have a modeler go ahead and create that, and then go ahead and rig it for animation, then animation's working on the different poses and getting it ready for production. So again, it can take a lot of different forms in regards to the production side when it comes to art. So again, concept art, knowing what this environment's gonna be like so that the environment artist can build that. The trick with the Wii, because it's not a next-gen game console, is how do we get the look and feel with this very, transparency is very hard to do in video games. And so how can we get this look and feel of Tron with neon, very limited color palette, based on the whole production, the colors there meant something. So we couldn't have any red in our game because it was gonna foretell, or it was giving away a secret of what was coming up in the movie. So all of that art direction was being channeled down from the actual feature film. And then we had our own version of it because our game was being taken place in a different Tron period. So again, also we can, how we integrate the logo, or we create the logo, or we can put on what the game title is. When you're dealing with branding, you have to be very careful about how that's represented. Sometimes that piece there is the last one you're going to get because it's got to go through all of the branding and the buy-off. So on the production side, I'm going to show some examples here. We've got schedules, we've got milestones, projections for the week, goals, calendars. We've got teamwork, communication, management, how I'm interacting with you guys, how you're interacting with your peers, or even other people if you've got a question. If you're working on a scene and you need to talk to somebody in the layout department, you know, you go down and you talk, I don't understand this camera movement. When I'm working on this, scale doesn't seem right, or it needs to, you know, be broader or something. You bring that up in the production approvals, and then if that's approved, that change will get noted and generated through the pipeline. So again, we've got outsourcing, freelancers, in-house staff, tracking the bugs, how we assign the bugs. Everybody has bugs. Sometimes are synonymous with tasks as well. So in regards to a video game production, we have one specific tracking software, and then you would be assigned, as soon as I would get them, if you were an environmental artist, then I would send them to the lead artist, and then they would send them out to the different crew, and you would know what your tasks were for either the week or for the month, depending on whatever that that time frame is. And then, of course, we've got QA testing that goes on quite a bit throughout the process in regards to video game process publisher approvals, which, again, can be director approvals if you're talking about film production, and then client feedback. Again, we continue to get these notes. How are we going to get the notes, and how are we going to get the project done in time? So let me show you a couple of examples here. Show of hands, how many people have seen Mulan? Okay. We may not have sound to some of this stuff, but then. So this is the pun charge, we called it. And so I'll let this play for a little bit, and I'll break it down a little bit. Okay. Okay, so for instance, this is this actually has CG rendered Hun horses and snow kick up and trails and shadows in the background. And so again, a lot of times in CG, especially traditional, there's some really close up camera shots. And a lot of times the directors would shy away from that because they really didn't want to put, you know, focus on the CG. But what we had to do in the case of the Hun charge is all of the elements, it's basically one horse and then two riders. And then we did replacement techniques with the uniforms. Same way with the horse, there could be different color maps on the nose, on the body to change the color, change the overall. You'll in film you hear the term color model. So all of those would go through the color model process and be approved through the art director. But then the all of this would go through software that was written by engineers in our department. So back in this type of production, I also had software engineers that were writing the simulation for all of this to take place. And so they would create a map, basically, so it's a little chaotic in there. So they would create, you know, a map that would mimic that so that the horses would pass that. And then the other fun thing that we had to do in CG is we have to take this information, the best way to describe it is we had two different systems. So in feature animation, if you had drawings, if you finished your scene, you took it down to the scanning department, they scanned it in, they had the camera information, it worked inside of proprietary Disney compositing software. And so that all worked fine. You introduce CG elements at this point, the two did not live together. So when I had artists that had to create these scenes, I had to take the physical scene, have it scanned, and then we had a scene setup person that would basically dock out that information with the camera and set it up in Maya. So that would work in the 3D world. And the artist would work in that, the technical director would do that, the same thing. And then when our work was completed, everything got docked back over into the CAP system, and then it could be composited. And all of that, there's a term called X sheet. So there's an X sheet or exposure sheet that every level would have to be exposed, and how long you were holding the drawings for, or the renders, or any of that. And in one of the sequences in the avalanche, basically they said like the X sheet could be rolled out of this building. It was just so long because it has to be taped together and every level is accounted for. Had to be when it was scanned individually and then also when it was hand-drawn. So again, there's a lot of elements that make up this environment, but when you come to 2D and 3D, you have, so for instance, the CG artist might be working with the 2D animator that was working on the scene or that did some of the horse animations and things like that. Like, what do I need in order to get that created? So basically, we had the models that had to be modeled, rigged, they had to be color modeled, the replacement system had to work inside of the software, and then once we had the scene, we had to be able to recreate what they were trying to do here, and then when the technical directors got the scene back to do final renders, they had to then create the look and then make that work inside of the approved color model scenes. And then all of that would go through. It would go to color dailies. If it was approved, you got counted, you know, the footage for the week and that type of thing. So that's a lot of what goes on. And that's frame by frame by frame by frame, every scene. And there is in... my next slide, I think. So this was the production pipeline. This is the journey that a scene would take, every scene. So that was, we had a tracking software called Fame, and that basically showed the whole travel of the scene. And then what I had to do was, this was called an integrated path. So that meant 2D and 3D were being done inside of the traditional department. So if there was rough animation, then I had to make sure that I was working with the rough animation APM to make sure that we would get the scene, we had enough time to do our work. We couldn't get counted for credit until both elements were done together. So basically, it had to travel all the way through that process to be through 2K color and go to film and be cut into the reel. And then what I would have to look at, because there were specific stops, every place was an area that I could set up a query and look. So if I needed footage for my artists, then I'm looking at what's coming out of layout that's approved in the Hun charge sequence, or I'm looking at what's happening in the crowd sequence, and so on and so forth. The other thing that happened with the Hun charge software is the directors realized that they wanted this huge, expansive crowd sequence where the crowds were all bowing. Well, at this point, it wasn't factored in to be 3D. So we came up with a technique that the engineers did where they could tweak the software some. We created characters instead of 3D models. We created actual animated characters that had cycles of either shifting or cheering or bowing. And then those were placed on cards. And then those cards could be manipulated in the software. And then based on the camera, you could get away with the perspective. And then the density that was created in the crowd was all painted, similar to what was being done for the Hun charge. You had a color map that would be there. So, you know, lighter would be sparser populated, darker would be more densely populated. And then they also had props, they had lanterns. So we were actually able to create that by tweaking the software to be able to accommodate that in the production timeline. And again, just one of the tools, again, because what I like to do in regards to management is, I'm not a micromanager. I like to provide the information. I allow the, I look at myself as a facilitator. I like to give the artist or the software engineer, whoever, the materials they need in order to do their job. And then they know the deadlines, they know what references do you need. So this is stuff that I would track on a weekly basis. So if we had rough animation, cleanup animation, rough effects, cleanup effects, all the way down into finals. If you had redos or retakes, it would count against you, but you still had to get it done. And so a lot of this stuff is basically, we would have a production meeting at the beginning of the week. We would say, here's what's coming up. Are we in production? Some people were still doing pre-production. Some people were actually doing production work. So I'm managing both of those areas. And then also, this would be a guide of, I've got it, you know, counted for the week, so I've got to make sure, hey, when do you have time to show? I need time to show. So that's the back and forth teamwork and communication that the process needs, because you have to be able to hit the 5 days goes very quickly, and you've got to get in front of the directors, because basically the way they live is a calendar, and it's blocked out per department, and it's all the various departments in the process, because from the film side, it's a very linear type of production process that everything goes through. So again, in regards to the overall process here, we've got effects. This is in regards to the Tron Wii game. We have environment. There's physics with these buggies. There was independent suspension in order for them to go over. If you can kind of see... there's like terrain that goes up and down in this area, and the buggies had to be able to adapt to that. There's UI, there's multiplayer planning, there's scoring. When it comes to video games, it was, quite a different mindset and challenge when I shifted over from feature film to video games, because going from a linear production process to a very fluid and ever-changing process is very challenging, because there's a lot that actually goes into the games. This is a basically a version, this is one scene, but this is a version of what the workbook was. So we created a digital version so that you knew what the level was, where it took place, what the
the rough layout kind of looked like, footage, and because we did our own, RTA stands for real-time animations. So we created our own for Tron. And so that sort of digital workbook would live there so that any animator that wanted to work on the scene could be able to basically, and we had it cut together so they could time it out and they'd be able to have all of the reference that they would need. So our art director was very adamant about having these types of tools for the artist to work with so that it helped, because what it does is it helps have all of the information in one place so that the person can get as much as they can to work independently, because art directors and people can be in various places, and if you have to wait for information, you may not get your scene or your work done. Another shot from the RTA. So here we have real world impacts of production. How many people have seen Lilo and Stitch? Okay. So we had,
what exactly are we doing?
Rescue.
We're gonna get Lilo?
Okay, so remember 9/11. So again, here's a story reel where you see rough, it's not colored yet, mixed in, then you'll see a color sequence. So the editorial reel is constantly being updated as the scenes get approved. That's a CG ship. Okay, so 9/11. So we were due to be finished. I think all scenes had to be cut. Oof. Now you'll see a good example of registration when it comes to 2D, 3D, where, if I didn't miss it, here, watch when it, on the curved building, because it's rough. Okay, so
what exactly are we doing?
Rescue.
So we had to be, I believe we had to be, all scenes had to be cut in by end of October or somewhere right before Thanksgiving or something like that. So 9/11 happens. The next day, I get a call from the production accountant saying, and I'm an assistant production manager. I'm not the producer. I'm not the director. I get a call. What's it going to take to change the 747 to another type of ship? And it did, you know, we're all processing 9/11. I mean, we don't even know what's going on. And now, plus I was in the process of moving myself. So I'm getting stuff to storage, and then I'm realizing, I'm like, oh, every scene that has a 747 is going to have to be changed. And then location and things like that. So I think we had somewhere between 13 or 14 shots that we had to change. Unfortunately, I will have to mute it at a certain point. I don't have this. These were all just from YouTube, so I was at the mercy of what somebody cut this stuff together. And I was amazed they had the 747 sequence on there. Let me jump ahead. We're going to get emotional and cry in a minute.
We're going to get Lilo?
Okay, so there's the color version of the rough scene that you saw before. Unless you'd like, I need a hero. Should I mute it, or?
No.
You like it? Okay. Right. I might start doing that. So now, same shot. This is what everybody, people that don't know, this is what they saw. And, you know, we couldn't, you know, they felt, well, this is going to launch in summer, so everybody's going to forget 9/11. So it's like, no, we had to change it. So what we ended up doing, I want to play it for a minute. So you get a good look at that. So you can see, let me show you the, so all of that's there. You can see that we replaced, that shot's very similar. So the difference is going to be in the location. Obviously, people that saw it, you know, it goes into this sort of volcano. So it goes into this volcano area to kind of, this ridge to kind of Blue's gone to ship, and that's as much as I need a hero as I can handle. So what ended up happening was, I get the phone call, and so the next, I forget when we, because they shut the studio down, they told us to go home, and I don't know if it was, you know, the end of that week or whatever. So basically, we had a very quick meeting with the CGI lead, the modeler, lead animator for digital. And they came up with a fix that would basically model the new Jumba ship, they called it. They could just change some of the parameters and the naming conventions from the 747 to the new ship. And in a sense, the Maya animation could be transferred to the new ship and then just kind of tweak it a little bit and see what happens. Certain cases, it was a new shot that had to be created. But for the most part, we were able to save the animation And then, you know, if we had to create a new shot, then we had the time to do that. What was going to be different is the effects department or backgrounds, you know, any of that stuff that was brand new, they were going to have to see how they created that. But you could see in that 747 shot when it came around the building, when those tires hit the building, when we rendered that, the other side of the 2D, 3D integration is my department, we had to print out frame by frame, or sometimes it could be on, you know, twos or fours, depending on the area. We would have to print out that reference with the camera specifics and then peg it for either traditional to draw to or effects, traditional character, I mean, or effects to draw the shards of glass. And, you know, sometimes we're printing and then, you know, registering that. So we've got crosshairs, we've got a registration guide. That was one of the other time-consuming aspects of the 2D, 3D integrated filmmaking. So it takes a lot of time when it comes to that, and especially with changes, because the undoing is very time-consuming. Let's see, then you can see their golf cart ranger team committed to completing the project once layoffs were announced to the studio. So I'm skipping ahead a little bit. What's next? Post-production. Let me talk about post-production here real quick. So again, let's say, you know, everything is finished. There's videos created for either vendors, or we've got to create a specific one for E3 that somebody's got to demo. SIGGRAPH is another one. I've got some artwork from the Mulan presentation that we did for SIGGRAPH. Create screenshots for publicity, the box art, packaging, support merchandise needs for characters, toys, whatever. And then at some point, what staff is left on the project still? Because you've got people, you know, that roll off as their department finishes. So depending on deadlines and when all this stuff happens, the promotional needs can be a little challenging to see how you actually get some of that done. That's why, in some cases, that schedule is created while you have those people there. It runs counter to what you're trying to do, because I don't get credit for saying, hey, I did five, you know, promo pieces today or something like that, you know, and the artist doesn't get credit for doing that. But it's something that we needed to do. Here's some screenshots. Again, these are used for publicity. In-game, they would want to see what it's looking like. Never make fun of Star Wars. I learned that. So, actually, let me come back to that. Here is I was talking about the post-production. This was needed for E3. So we would have a video capture software, and we would just sit there and go through, play various aspects of the game, get specific shots that they were looking for, and then we would cut it together, and they would use it to play in the monitors of E3, and then we'd also have a Wii setup where we would be actually, you know, playing the game live. Or this video would go out for promo use. What's that?
What game was this? 2011 or
10? 10, I think 10. It finished, yeah. We had challenges with the characters. We had a head replacement system. And all of a sudden, Cora is the female version there. All of a sudden, her face would be distorted on another female character's face. Somebody would have half a mohawk, it would cut through the model penetrations were crazy. And another thing that happens, obviously, is frame rate. There's a lot of stuff that goes on in this game. And renders can leave particles behind. If that particle's there, it's gonna smash frame rate. So the engineers are constantly going to try to solve that. Another thing we do in regards to using new technology and things like that for the process is if we were testing a game and we got a crash, there's the engineers had specific information on the crash screen. So we would basically take a picture of it with our iPhone, email it to the engineer, the lead engineer, and they already, you know, had them working on it. And so we would do that as we got the crashes.
What do you mean at E3?
No, I'm sorry, just in production.
Oh, in production.
That was just done for E3. In going for builds, because with video games, you're dealing with a milestone production schedule, so you have to have various builds done, and those builds are challenging, they crash, and what am I doing, how am I doing time-wise? We okay for now?
Yeah. Well, maybe not as long as you want, no.
So, just for kicks.
Does anyone know how many frames are in a foot of movie film?
No. Oh, no. Tell us, Mr. Audio.
Prior to the switch to nonlinear workstations that happened in Hollywood in the 1990s, picture editors worked with film work prints and sound editors used sprocketed magnetic film.
So I don't go back this far, but I'll show you how when I started on Equalizer and Law and Order, we actually had to synchronize the film through here.
The synchronizer had several sprocketed wheels that were all locked together and guides that could lock the film reels to the wheels to keep them from slipping out of sync. The Moviola synchronizer had a 4-digit footage counter, and the wheels also had divisions that indicated the frame number within that foot. Since 35mm film was 3/4 inch frame to frame, there were 16 frames in every foot. Even though film is edited today on digital workstations without the Moviola synchronizer, Hollywood editors continue to use feet plus frames to indicate the timing on movie reels.
Thanks, Mr. Audio.
For more interesting facts about sound, visit Mr. Audio at Sound Images.
Mr. Audio is very helpful. So again, when we, when they would go on set, they would have said that this is for like Law and Order or for the Equalizer, and probably for a lot of the serial shows that are out there. When they shot on film, they had a run called dailies, which was about 7 to 8 days, and then. I was an apprentice film editor, and so my responsibility was to synchronize the dailies, and there were three teams basically in this group, and so whenever a team was in dailies, we would basically just jump on trying to synchronize the dailies as fast as we could, because the producers and the directors and everybody, they were going to be looking at this and making sure that they had the right coverage, and the scenes were working and that kind of a thing. So. All of the, so somebody had to mark the picture, so whenever you saw the clapper, you had to mark that as your start. Somebody was listening for the audio, and that's how you did it by hand back during that, and then for 7 days. And then once they finished that, then the editor was working on a moviola or working on a flatbed, and then my job was basically to manage all of those, the feet and frame, basically. And sometimes they can get down to creating, you know, like one perf cut. And if they need that full frame back again, you're digging through these bags and trying to find the missing piece, and it's crazy. So you can see how the computer editing has just streamlined all of that. I mean, people don't even know that, you know, some of that stuff was done, you know, in regards to production. Let's see. I wanted to show. So not to bore you with Excel. Let's see. But for instance, to give you an idea of, this would be our milestones. So this would be the schedule that we had to work on. So all of the milestones are there. Till we get to finish. Then you still have to deal with the publisher getting approval and Nintendo approval and everything. And then we had environments. So we would list all of the different environments. So we had the art tasks and what that was going to be. Now this is just high level. That's not dealing with all the individual tasks. This is just per milestone. So then there's hubs, there's characters, which ones are playable, which ones are non-playable vehicles, effects, UI, you name it, you know, and then come down to the types of games that we were playing. That was going to decide what animations we needed, and then on down to inside of there is also going to be engineering tasks or any other types of tasks that we would need. One thing that I did on Marvel Ultimate Alliance is I created, for the world building team, I created just a calendar in effects or in Excel that just listed, here was our start, anything that was going on, what somebody was supposed to do, when it was due, when they were switching levels, and then that would be part of our group meeting. We would hand that out. Now you've got your month or you've got your milestone plan. Now, is it going to go that way? Obviously, we know things can change. Somebody finishes up early, they might be able to help. Somebody might be having trouble doing their objects or something like that, you know? But this is basically a guide. Not everything is written in stone, but again, the way that I managed is I tried to give the information to the art staff or to the engineering staff and then allow them to delegate it out. You know, here's people that were out so that people knew, you know, that kind of a thing. So just, you know, handy, so just handy stuff like that, because again, what this document does at that point is allows us to have breakout meetings. So then we have to have specific meetings to say, okay, what physics are going to be needed for that buggy? What physics or what effects are going to be needed? What's it going to look like, you know? And then we have to go on and break it all down from there. So the breakout meetings can take time. Everybody loves having meetings, but the meetings are important. So you have to look at your audience. You have to look at what you're trying to get. You have to get the information as fast as you can and then try to get it out to folks. And in the video game world, we used a system called Mantis, which basically was a bug tracking software. And so we would import all of the new tasks, and then we would divide them out by animation, world building, engineering effects, UI, so on and so forth. And then those would be given out to the different artists throughout the process. And that's how you knew when you saw a new task coming in, you saw that. I would know which one you're working on because you had one called acknowledged or in progress or something like that. And then whenever you would finish one, you would say it was resolved and you would assign it back to either your lead or to myself, and then I would know and I would keep track of that. And that's how I'm, you know, keeping track of what we've got completed for the milestone. And I think that brings us back to PowerPoint here. So again, a lot of this in the setting that we're in, you guys are studying, you're learning, you're wondering how you can put a lot of this artistic talent and creativity to use. Hopefully, you know, in what I've shown you, you can see, I mean, it's impossible to go through it in the time that we have, but basically you can see the various types of roles that are out there. You know, if you want to be a modeler, you can, you know, if you want to do the modeling and you want to do the rigging, if you just want to specialize in the rigging, I should say the rigging is doing the, making sure that you've got the joints and being able to set up the character so it can be animated. There's all of these different types of work that's out there. If you want to be a concept artist, there's a lot of places that will hire concept artists. And they get a sequence, they get information, and then their job is to create what the environment is going to be. Some people can be character artists. Some people are sculptors. The sculptor is really one of the 3D artists that created the model for the Hun Charge. She sculpted it out. It was easier for her to see it in 3D, real 3D first, before she went into the computer, because she came from that background. So people that sculpt become very, very good modelers, CG modelers, because they're able to see that in the various ways. So again, apply a lot of what you're doing to the real world. We're always marketing ourselves, even if it's inside of a production. You know, if somebody's coming to you for an estimate, you have to know what your estimate is. You have to stand by your estimate. You have to know, you have to be comfortable with how you're coming up with that estimate or asking questions back, whether that's, and that could be dealing with like a client, you know, if you have your own business. So you want to know, hey, how long is it going to take to do this website or to do this graphic? So you know, art is a very subjective world, and I may come in and say, hey, I need this. And then you go ahead and you finish it in color, and I'm like, did we have the same meeting? Wait a second, why does it look like this? The color's all off, or whatever. So that's why a lot of the, you set up those pre-meetings, you get a lot of that information out there. What's the market? What are you looking for? Do you have a color scheme? Do you have a certain target market for an audience or whatever? Do you have a logo? Am I creating a logo? Because sometimes people just expect that all of that is wrapped in. They don't know the difference. They just think it's all one piece. So the more you are, informed with a lot of that, going out into the real world and applying that, you'll be able to market yourself in various ways, whether it's looking for a job, whether it's looking to promote yourself through the ranks. In regards to the video game world, you had leads, you had, and then levels of world builders or artists, basically, based on their either seniority or based off of what their skill set was. And so you can go up the ranks that way. Sometimes the best artist is not the person to be the lead of that group, because you're also managing there too. So you have to be able to not only do the work yourself and be responsible for your deadlines, you have to manage what your department needs, you have to be able to get that out there, you're in other meetings, so your time is being taken up, and maybe you're not able to be the best person to disseminate that information. Maybe your best contribution is making sure that you're a senior level, because I know that I can crank the workout, and they know that, hey, if it's a difficult sequence, we need to get it to this person because they can get it done, faster or better quality, or they've got a certain, skill set for that. So a lot of stuff that's out there, obviously having portfolios, websites to show off your work, LinkedIn profiles, connections. You can do a lot of research now that you never could do before. When you're looking for work, you can look up companies, you can look up people, internships, committees for local groups, volunteers, networking, all that type of stuff. And, those are all just important skills to have. So, and learn about the business and the marketing side. And, because you've heard me, I've had 3 layoffs, basically, from studios either closing or from having to downsize or from not having, in the case of Endspace, the projects, we all ended, all the teams that were there, we all ended projects around about the same time, and we didn't get any projects confirmed that would allow for the headcount to be paid for, so we couldn't meet payroll. So that's how we were laid off, basically, at that point. And then I'll leave you with, before I do that, I wanted to show you the golf cart thing, so I mentioned that. And then for the Photoshoppers out there, I didn't want to bring it into the present. So, again, you can be captured and put anywhere, basically. And having a thick skin is certainly helpful. And then, the setup for this one. This is a promo video that we did, but this is for the iPhone. So when I finished Tron, I managed about 15 people, and we started coming up with ideas to create, because the owner wanted to explore the iPhone game. So we researched how to do it, and we started we got the technology to do it, and we created Golf Cart Ranger, which is available on the App Store. So again, the backgrounds, there were various different ones. The user interface had to be created. And what I mentioned, in the beginning, or on that one slide, was just close to the finish of that. We got the news that we were most likely going to have layoffs, and we didn't know exactly who it was going to affect. And so what I was trying to motivate the crew with was, hey, is everybody, I know there's a lot of distractions out there, but one good thing that we could do to just focus our energies is let's get this thing as close as we can. We don't know exactly what's going to happen, but let's get this thing as close as we can to release. Maybe somebody's got to tweak it down the road or whatever. So everybody was gung-ho for that, and we were able to get it done. So, you know, you never know what the real world's going to give you, but again, everybody teams up in that, you know, effort and really, you know, works out to make it happen. So that's kind of my world there, and I know I've put a lot of stuff out there. Hopefully it's been interesting to you from the artistic side to see how different roles and how the art works inside of these types of businesses. And I'll open up for questions.
All right, well, first of all, thanks very much for that.
Oh, you're welcome.
Questions?
I'll send these around if anybody wants to take a look. This is just so you can kind of see the... what we had to do. The two tagged areas are a little bit more information on the Hun charge and the crowds in there, if anybody's curious for that.
So now we got any questions? Anyone questions?
You know, I hate to sound stupid, but I didn't know what you meant by CG.
That's okay. Computer generated.
Okay.
Yeah. It's called various things, but when we worked, it was the CGI department, computer generated image. That's what they were referring to. Then it changed to digital production. So yeah, so anything CG, again, now it's just, you know, and it's just taken for granted for what's out there. But back in those environments, everything was CG.
Okay. In those environments, where there sounded like a lot of on the job training, pretty much learning these brand new programs.
For the artist or for myself?
For the artist,
yeah. There, for instance, right before the studio was closed down in 2004, again, Pixar was really out there, and DreamWorks was coming on strong, and a lot of them were starting to transition over into just digital movies. Disney set up Maya training, and so the traditional artists could start to train in Maya. And Maya's again, feel free to shout out anything because acronyms and are very prevalent in all of the production process. But Maya is one of those 3D software packages where you're able to do animation inside of there. So our group we were also available for that training, but Disney set up specific training so that the traditional artists could start to learn the 3D software. And then for instance, if there was work being done inside the studio for the look development team, the technical directors, or for the engineers, they had to keep up with what the, because most of the core software was being written out in California, and then they would have to write our programs on top of that. So for instance, in Mulan, anything that we did would have to work inside of the core software that we were using for the studio. Same thing for Tarzan. I would imagine most people have seen the animated movie Tarzan. That was one of the big CG model where they were really doing a lot of work with the obviously flying through the jungles and swinging and stuff like that, where models were the vines in the area and the trees and stuff like that. They were modeled. They would create the camera moves, and then they also created a technique called deep canvas, which allowed the background artist to create that painterly effect so that the model did not look like it was CG rendered. So again, that one, all of that had to be written on top of software. Then they started changing it so that the budgets, all of the development was being done and the tools were being done in California, and then we had to use those tools with whatever productions that we wanted to use.
So, I mean, one obvious question that no one's asked yet. So, I mean, there's lots of artists who say that sculptures, and all. I mean, how did you go from graduation? I mean, you did it yourself, you in your background, going up to New York to get work on Law and Order and all that. I mean, looking at the sort of young punk rock kids coming into Disney, I mean, how do you go from graduation to artist, creative lead, all those sort of things?
None of it is easy. There are certain paths that I think or certain areas that have maybe a clearer definition on the art side, I think you can end up coming in a certain way and then seeing what's available and then molding, you know, yourselves to different jobs. But for instance, you know, for me, you know, like I put on the slide, I did an internship up in New York for an independent filmmaker, and did a lot of stuff. You know, was it related to some of the stuff that I was studying in school? Yeah, some of it was. But again, I had a bit of a broader background. It wasn't just a specific topic. But what it did is I got to meet different people in the production world up there. That's how I got introduced into people that were working inside of Universal for the Equalizer. That's how I got into, I just started working in the production office. And so we would basically assist the office manager. We would work on the daily call sheets. We would work on the scripts, making sure everybody had the latest scripts. If we had to go out on location, we would assist people out on location. We did a lot of different stuff. Then I started hanging around the editorial department, and then that's when I got into editorial. There was an opening, and you start just going over to Technicolor and getting the film. And then you bring it over and you're doing the dailies, you know, and then somebody's training you. Again, back then, it was how you did it, you know, by hand. But again, you're being taught on the job. But you've got your foot in the door. They know you. You know, so a lot of that still goes in. That's still part of the networking thing, because unless you ask what you do or, you know, what business are you in, you know, start a conversation like that. Networking is not, it doesn't come easy. It can be uncomfortable because you feel like maybe you don't have anything in common with anybody. But again, it's about, you know, building the relationships and finding out maybe that person knows somebody that knows somebody, and all of a sudden that person is working. I'll use Chico's as an example because there's some people that I've had to use for events that are in multimedia, and they do a lot of stuff in multimedia. You know, there's also a company down in Benita that does pretty high-end production and websites. Called For What. You start doing the research. There's a lot of new government dollars that are being funneled down in this area. Arthrex is also looking for very technical type work, but again, they have web development there. They have specific work for engineers as well. And they may even have somebody that does concept work, you know, inside of whether it would be CAD or things like that. So there's a lot of, you know, you may have to do a little bit more research there, but again, perseverance is always a key. It's not taught. That's character driven. That's who you are, and you just have to get out there. If you're learning here, and your goal is not to be in the, you know, Lee County, Fort Myers, Naples area, then start looking to see where you want to go, or look at what those companies, where those companies are that you want to be. You know, if Pixar is your dream. You know, start researching Pixar, start seeing how some people get in. I've had artists that didn't do a drop of digital animation when they first got out there. They were all traditional artists, and they ended up getting out there, starting in the story department at first, and then working their way slowly into learning the 3D software and then being animators. I still have... I know technical artists that are working still at the Disney Studios. Also, somebody out at Lucas at both studios. They've got a lot of production work. Lucas is doing a lot of work overseas. You know, that's again where we hear all of the outsourcing. Philippines, South Korea, a lot of production companies. And sometimes I was talking to Michael about this before. There are universities there that are actually doing production work because they have different business development with the government, and they're doing theme park, you know, like what you would see inside of a Spider-Man, you know, attraction or things like that. But again, locally, if you're here and you're going to be here for a while and you're going to transition, try to get whatever kind of skills or opportunities that you can, because that's the first step on the ladder for your resume, and then you build off of that. I'm a firm believer you always can take something constructive out of any position that you have, because like I said, it goes back to your character, goes back to your principles, it goes back to your work ethic. If they see that, they know you bring this level, they know you're going to bring that level to everything that you do. you know, and that's why they're hiring. That's why they're hiring for you, because a lot of times they're not hiring you for that. They don't necessarily see you in that position for 5 years. They're saying, hey, I want to bring you in, and they see you, you know, because we're building ahead. We want to see where this person's going to go. So it might be short term. You're coming in to fill this role as a concept artist, but then we want you to be, you know, an art director, because we know that art director is going to maybe go into producing or directing or something like that, you know. Or if you're in a bigger environment, maybe there's multiple teams that are being created. At Endspace, we had, I think at our highest, we had maybe five projects going on at the same time. Now, we didn't always have, you know, an art director for all of them. Sometimes they were being driven by outside projects, but we had multiple art directors. We had several different leads of environments or animation. So you can then look to cross over. And by you building those relationships with other people, they say, hey, we'd like to have so-and-so on the team. This person would be a great person to lead animation. But a lot of it starts with the research and seeing, you know, look at what makes up, you know, their company. Look at what makes up their website. You know, are they doing promotional work? Are they doing graphic work? Again, they might be doing it out of house because, you know, they think that that's their recipe right now. But if they have somebody that's capable to do maybe a few different things, maybe that's your in at first, you know, and you kind of start from there. And then again, have a time frame. Look at what you're looking to do. If it's modeling and you're looking to, you know, be in the 3D area, or if you're looking to find out, you know, other companies that where you can use those strengths, look at what those are, you know. Find out the cities, find out the demographics.
Other questions? Anyone? All right, great. Well, thanks very much, Stephen.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate it.
Can you hang out?